Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of Emkay Global Financial Services, I take the opportunity to welcome you all to discuss the brief overview of Dynamatic Technologies Limited and its performance. We have with us Mr. Udyant Malhotra, CEO and Managing Director, Mr. Arvind Mishra, ED and Global CEO of Hydraulics and Head of Homeland Security, Mr. Ravichandran V, Co-CEO of Aerospace, Mr. Ajay Gururaj, Head Business Development and CRM, Mr. P. Chalapathy, CFO. We thank the management for providing us with the opportunity to host the call. A reminder that today's session is being recorded. We request the management to make a presentation on the company's business segments and its performance, which can be followed by a Q&A session. Over to you, sir.
This meeting is being recorded.
Toby, you are on mute.
Oh, am I on mute? Can you unmute me, please? Yes. Can you hear me now?
Yes. Thank you.
Okay. I'm sorry. Firstly, I'd just like to thank Emkay Global for facilitating today's meeting. I'd like to wish everyone happy, a good afternoon, and thanking everybody for joining us today. I'm going to make a small overview on the company to try and explain who we are, why we've gotten to where we are, and try and give you a sense of where we are right now and what's going to happen in front of us. But it's going to be more a business presentation. So with that, Ajay, if you can just flip the slide, please. So if you see us, we're a company that started in Bangalore. We developed ourselves with a global market and a global manufacturing footprint. So we're manufacturing in India, we're manufacturing in the United Kingdom, we're manufacturing in Germany, and we have a small fishing, minor manufacturing operation in North America as well, with a very strong engineering footprint across these places. Ajay? So if you look at what we do, we design and manufacture very high engineered products. We have a lot of patents and trade secrets and design registrations that give us a very unique place in the global market for hydraulics, for complex aerostructures, and some complex metallurgical parts that were used in the hot end of engines and also in safety parts like brakes. If you look at the gear pump business, which is where we started, it's a product that one would look at it and say it's a tractor part or something that goes into construction equipment, but it's really the heart of every hydraulic system. It generates 4,000 pounds per square inch pressure. It's actually the muscle that does all the work when you see a bulldozer or a crane or a drill rig or a tractor. It's a very high precision product with a lot of industrial IP in it, and we have a large number, I think, of our 21 patents, 13 of them are in this area. So we have a very nice market share. We have a global market share of 34% in ag tractors. In India, it's north of 75%. So we're very dominant in this sector, and we manufacture in the UK and in India. There are two broad segments, and I think we're entering into a very nice super cycle of growth in India. With the advent of all these new superhighways that have been built at record pace. One of the interesting things that you all would have seen as investors is the big bounce that tractor companies have taken. So if you look at Mahindra, you look at Escorts, all of them have been tearing despite COVID. And part of it has been the use of ag tractors, not just for plowing fields, but as equipment for haulage, construction, for moving construction materials. What's also very interesting is the growth of the construction equipment industry in India. Suddenly, there's a domestic industry. A lot of global players have come into India. Komatsu was always there, but now you have Schweinsteiger and all kinds of companies that are really growing and are consuming hydraulic products. So the pump, of course, is the part of the system, but we also make a whole bunch of other products. And I'll talk about that, and I'll say, I'll give you an example of why we are set for a very interesting growth cycle. So if you look at the gear pump, we have a monopoly. I mean, anybody with 75% market share in a country like India, you could say it's a monopolistic product. But we never really had pricing pressure because there was a mutuality. We were serving the customer. We had a nice 16-17% EBITDA margin. It was a very nice cash cow that funded our other growth into aerospace and into automotive. But there was always this kind of mutuality. It was like a monopsony where you had large OEMs on the other side that gave you sole supply kind of contracts, but on your side, you were also very respectful. And that continues to be the case. What is very interesting is that in recent times, the market has really flipped upwards, especially with the government's investment in the rural areas and the shift to construction, as I talked about earlier. So for the first time, we have not only growth, but massive pricing power, because the tractor OEMs, all of whom we love, are literally now bidding with each other to buy more of our products. So that's one part. The second part is the shift from pure market share to wallet share. So if you look at it, we make a gear pump, which is 1500 rupees in a tractor. But what you see on the screen is about 30-35,000 rupees. In the top right, you see the rock shaft assembly. That itself is 20,000 rupees. So for Same Deutsch Car, we are a sole supplier for entire HU. For Ace New Holland, for Eicher Tractors, and for Same, we also make the hitch control valve on the bottom right. And like that, we've just developed a new power steering valve. So this will literally take what is currently a 300 crore business of ours. We could, over the next 4 or 5 years, grow this very significantly with the wallet share. So there are two or three things. One is the volume growth. The second is pricing opportunities that we have, and the third is the wallet share. The next slide, please, AJ. So if you look at this business, as we get the volume, we're automating it, becoming more and more repeatable with the use of robots, like what we do in our European plants. We're investing in low-cost automation, which dramatically increases the productivity of these plants. And as a consequence, with the same headcount, with similar labor costs, we're able to actually grow the volume. And as I mentioned earlier, there's a lot of strong patent and IP protection around these products. Next one, please. So this is a very interesting story. All of us look at COVID as a very grave risk. In India, surprisingly, and this is the data that speaks for India, for Bharat, tractors is almost a weather vane for what 80-70% of India is doing or thinking or feeling like. And you can see the dip. You know, if my guess is if we didn't have this COVID, we would have had a recession at the early part of last year. You can see there was a very strange decline in tractor OEMs. And then you hit a complete rapid shutdown with the lockdown. And after that, we've been on steroids with this Atmanirbharta and the government's focus on the rural sector. So you can see a very rapid growth that we had shown, which was a bounce immediately after that. But let me tell you, it hasn't stopped. That trajectory continues. And so what you see on the left as 1,20,000, it's like 175 now. We are unable to meet demand. We're just not able to meet the demand. So, as I mentioned, it's a nice place to be. Okay, the next slide. I will move from the hydraulic business, which is really serving the ag tractor and now the growth of construction equipment, into something that people have been very excited about in Dynamatic for the last many years. And part of the reason they were so excited about it was that we've always been one of the pioneers in India. In the listed space, we're one of those very rare companies. Unfortunately, while we all had great hope that opportunity for Indian manufacturing in defense has taken years, very recently you've seen the new positive list, which create a moat around Indian defense manufacturing for indigenization for local companies. And I think that is something we've been waiting for from 2014, and it's here and now. So let me go back into 1990, when we were making tractor hydraulics for tractors. The Soviet Union collapsed. The Indian Army had Soviet equipment. They weren't able to get hydraulic products. And even though defense production was, the private sector was stopped from getting into that sector, into defense production, by virtue of our hydraulic knowledge, we went into and ventured into that area. And we developed all the hydraulic products for the T-72 tank. We won national awards for that. We then developed a lot of products with DRDO for the Indian main battle tank. The next slide, please. And then in a little garage behind the hydraulic plant, we started making aerostructures for another DRDO lab and the research lab of HAL, making aerostructures for their new prototypes, their new UAVs and jet trainers. And very, in a very small scale, and mind you, this is, I've been here a long time, this is 30 years ago, we had a great privilege of working with some of India's leading scientists in the nuclear program, and in the missile program, and winning a lot of awards and everything. So in a sense, a lot of the young engineers that I worked with as a youngster myself are today at the very top of the industrial military complex of India, which is largely state government. So we were a pioneer there. The largest program in India, which is the Sukhoi program, you can see we actually had a dynamatic factory inside HAL in Nasik. So it was the first and only private sector facility within a defense PSU. And you can see about 1/6 of the airframe was produced by. So this gave us a certain set of wings. We went from prototyping into series production, but it was 16 to 18 aircraft every year. But for that, we developed 3,500 parts per aircraft to make those 6 or 8 families of assemblies. And for 20 years, we were HAL's best supplier. Next. So around 2005-2006, Airbus was looking for global supply chain partners. They were trying to dollarize their procurement footprint because they were competing with Boeing. And one of the products they looked at, which was very interesting, which is a class one light critical product. It's the flap track beam assemblies, which the wings, which actually shape the rear end of the wing to make the plane take off and to come down to give lift to the aircraft. And they went to China, they went to Russia, they went to Indonesia, they went to Czech Republic, they went to Poland, and they came to India. And these were made in the UK, and they found that we had the same language, we had the same law, and they had very strong engineering talent within India. They went to all the biggest names in India. And of course, they went to HAL and they came to Dynamatic, which was producing a small volume of aeronautic products, but had very mature automotive rigor of manufacturing. And they really liked the fact that we were entrepreneurial, we were responsive. And it was a real karmic moment for us where we won this business and became a global sole supplier to Airbus for their largest selling A320 family. So every A318, 319, 320, 321 were sole supplier for the flat track beam assemblies. And it's been the mainstay of our business. And of course, we did a lot of engineering work. And in 2021, we've developed a new product that is going to go into commercial production in about 2 months, which will replace the old product, where the IP is actually co-developed by us and the customer. So it's a really new level of manufacturing and capability. The next slide, please. So this is actually a 4-story flatted building in Dynamatic. We move parts up and down. We take advantage of efficiency of space. And you can see the kind of manufacturing here. It's really high class, high quality stuff, and it's world class manufacturing. What is quite unique is what we were able to do, which was take this is, by the way, taught at IIM Ahmedabad as a case study. And Professor Jim Rice at MIT in the US is working on a case study on this, on how Dynamatic converted or upended the global supply chain, where we actually moved the final assembly to a low-cost country, and we make the detailed parts in a high-cost country, or really close to the aircraft manufacturer. And the reason we did that was, on the left, what it is, we had a clean sheet of paper. We didn't have legacy. So we could look at this and we could use basic first principle thinking. We looked at where the cost of capital is high, where it is low. Cost of capital is very high in India. So to put in those sophisticated machines for the parts was just unviable. But for assembly, for artisanship, for craftsmanship, for engineering, nobody could beat us in Bangalore. And in the UK, we could get the best German and Swiss machines at 2% interest. Put robots in there, you had very few workers, and you have a completely robotized plant. So I'll show you, I'll take you into a minute and a half of what this business is. It's a real jewel, and it's what really generates it. The new build process that we have already invested in. We're about to take off in about 2 months, and we're also getting set for a rise in volumes. As you know, the COVID period has been very, very difficult for civil aviation, and I'd just like to show you the advantage we've had is traditionally we try to keep half our business defense and half civilian. And a lot of people actually were critical because in civil aviation, you have much larger volumes. But we always thought that there was a certain risk mitigation available to us with these two counter-cyclical markets. And COVID really showed that this was a good thesis. Because as we found a reduction in, a steep reduction in commercial jetliners, we had our typical export business, partly in India, but largely As we said, we were waiting for the opening up of the Indian defense sector. In the last 6 years, we were not sitting still. We developed a large global export order. And so we are sole supplier for Boeing P-8 power and mission cabinets for all their aircraft worldwide. These are the very formidable submarine hunting maritime aircraft. The next slide, please. So these are nice, beautiful internal to the aircraft power and mission cabinets, and it's a beautiful business. Even in this last COVID year, we've delivered roughly 100 crores worth of this, which is fantastic. All right, and it was a very robust business. The second Boeing product we have is this iconic heavy lift helicopter, where again their global sole partner for the pylon and ramp, both are very complex structures. The next slide, please. And with this, actually what was very interesting was Make in India for Defense was actually launched with these products in the 2015 air show by our Prime Minister. Next slide. This is a very interesting R&D program we did with Boeing during the COVID lockdown. This is the world's first completely digitally designed aircraft, the T-7. And to validate the design, you have something called a Whiffle Tree, which was produced by us in 90 days. So it was concurrent engineering and manufacturing of the twins and test unit. And of course, last year, we were one of the first 10 companies worldwide to get their general performance gold award worldwide. So it is a very, we're one of the elite suppliers, as we are with Airbus. Next slide, please. This is one of the most unique case studies that we have is the Bell 407. It's the world's largest selling helicopter. The entire Bell cabin, the entire fuselage is made by us. It's about 1,600 parts. We've replaced 56 suppliers, and we now deliver it in 5 sub-assemblies. And going forward, it'll be delivered in 1 assembly. What is incredible is the opportunity for cost arbitrage, not just in manufacturing, but the entire value chain of cleaning up the engineering, digitizing, optimizing, and then world-class managing. And I think this is the future. What we've done is we are now a tier one and a single source to Airbus, to Bell Helicopter, and to Boeing. And that's been a very, it's given us gray hairs, all of us, but it's been, actually, it's a great business, very profitable, and it's set to grow in future because we are now at full rate for all these customers. And now we have to really focus on growth orders, on the campaigns that we're working on with them. Please go on. Within the Indian defense industry, this is with the HAL, so Sukhoi production shutdown, with the new light combat aircraft, and the main fuselage is built by us. You can see a small, during the lockdown, small ceremony with the Defense Secretary of India live streaming onto our shop floor, the chairman of HAL. It's a very close partnership we have. We are really an intel inside the Indian defense industry. So as this opens up, as big as that opportunity is, your guess is as good as mine. We've got our fingers crossed as well, but that's where we are. And I think it's the time, we are in the 2020s now. These are some of the early wins we got during COVID. As the commercial jetliner market was down, we had equipment and capacity available, and we developed some of these items. You saw that complex machining on the video. These are really complex products that go into a complete assembly, which is classified in India. But you can see the first deliveries, and this is really interesting. Please go ahead. These are tooling. So while we had capacity, we built toolings for the Dassault Rafale and installed it, and it's become really neat because we built for our own production and for our customers, but we started developing products for Dassault, and now we've come the other way around with orders for parts on which we'll go on to our group. Please go ahead. Again, for the Rafale, please go ahead. A very sophisticated jigs for manufacturing the aircraft. Now, this is what I was talking about earlier, that roughly half and half production of civilian to defense. AJ, what was the mix during the last year for defense? It ramped up, right, to about almost 70%, two-thirds?
Yeah, two-thirds, one-third was the defense commercial.
Yeah. So as you all can see, we tried to keep it half and half, and we kept it as a risk mitigation thing. And during this COVID period, we were able to put our foot on the accelerator and take up some of the slack. And to some element or some level, we were able to countervail the reduction in aerospace through commercial jetliner sales. And then you see we've tried to keep roughly 25% of our production in helicopters. Next slide, please. Within India, we have agreements with Israel Aircraft Industries and HAL. So as the Heron, which is the big UAV which patrols our hostile borders, as they become Make in India, they will be essentially built by Dynamatic and HAL in a very similar partnership that you've seen before. We're working with IIT Kanpur on certain militarized mini drones. Please go on. And you can see how over 3 decades we've gone from hydraulic pumps to precision parts to complete assemblies is a tier one. So that's just the journey where we are at. Now going forward, again, I'm not going to give numbers, but just these are headlines from the newspapers. More and more Poseidons being bought, more and more business. It's continuous. It's increasing. It's a very healthy business. Keep going. What is really interesting is the big bounce that Airbus has seen. So Boeing, while it is very strong in defense, they've had setbacks with their 737, and Airbus is very, very bullish in a post-pandemic world, and you can see the guidance. It is much higher than what was the pre-pandemic volumes. And, you know, just so you know, this is public information. We have access to far deeper information, and it's all very real, and it will give us a few years of good growth going forward. Please go ahead, Ajay. Now, coming to the third leg of our business, so we built a global best value model in aerospace, a global best value model in our hydraulic business, and we were trying to build a global best value model between our German and Indian foundries. And this is an area which really suppressed if you just go ahead, it was a terrific business in terms of the technical success. We took on great challenges. We succeeded in developing a whole slew of very difficult products for difficult Japanese customers in India. But the Indian foundry of ours just perennially lost money. The German foundry always made money for us. Even in the worst time, it's breaking even. But what has been terrible for us has been this Indian foundry, and we just divested it after 5 years of real losses. And just to give you an idea, we are losing 20, 25 crores a year, but we were winning all the awards. And we always had that sense that next year you will develop. So we held on to it with hope while we were developing all these new products across the business line. But that one was a dud and we got rid of it. Now what remains is a very interesting world-class metallurgy capability in Germany. And let me show you what we're going to do with this. So we've actually robotized a lot of the manufacturing there, and we're now integrating it more with our aerospace manufacturing. So this is it's in a place called Erzgebirge, which means all mountains. It's the heart of metallurgy worldwide, the location there in Schwarzenberg. Please go ahead. So in our UK plant, I mentioned the low cost of capital versus the low cost of labor, but there's another secret. It's the raw materials. In aerospace, raw materials are all qualified and carefully controlled, and we generate a huge amount. When you machine an aircraft part, you take out 90-92% of the material, and you just have a net shape. That 90-92% of the material in India would be ruddy and sold to a scrap merchant. In the UK, we bricket it, and it's given back to the mill. But this is a very valuable. So we've captured some of the value by keeping our machining close to the mill. But if you go to the next slide, you'll see what we are actually integrating it. In the last year, during the COVID, we got this plant manufactures products from Maserati, Porsche, BMW, Audi, and Daimler. It's a fantastic capability of German metalworking. Now, what we've realized is that all our businesses are really difficult and technically challenging, but there are certain customers who pay you better or pay you more for your skill. They value your artisanship and craftsmanship. And maybe that's the blue ocean. And that's why you see us talking about blue sky, blue ocean. So what our intention is, rather than seeing the German plant as an adjunct to India and trying to create that value, this was the other very big interesting opportunity for us. Because this plant doesn't lose money, it's there. We've been transferring aerospace knowledge and capability into it and qualification into it. And over time, what we're going to do is we're going to actually bring this into the supply chain. Now, across the world, there's a shortage of castings and forgings for aircraft. And there's a surplus of castings and forgings in the automotive industry. But there's a big gap in qualification. It's very rare to have a company like ours, which is both AS and PS, which is the qualifications for these two different businesses. Keep going, please. So my last few slides, I just want you to know during this entire pandemic, we set up our own. Early in February last year, we understood that this was going to hit us. Even before it was publicly announced on the 5th of Feb last year, we started our anti-COVID activities. We brought out technology and developed it from the Indian Institute of Science and built our own world-class RT-PCR testing capability. All our employees, all 2,000, were regularly tested. In fact, during this peak second wave, we were testing every week. We were doing 8,000 tests a month internally. We have almost zero infection rates, while there was 26% positive test ratios around Bangalore. We have vaxxed 100% of our employees' wives, our supply chain, the suppliers, small suppliers. So what we've done is we've created a very safe space for our ecosystem to be sustainable through this period. Next slide, please. And also for the customers, you've got to understand there are customers across the world seeing people dying and you know, our business is a global business, most products. So we developed on the fly all these technologies in-house would be deployed. So all our products are also certified to be biosecure. We do UV sterilization of every aircraft part before it's packed and it's shipped out. So these are all on the boxes, please go ahead. And as a consequence, even our global customers have got on video calls with us and shared how happy they are with this. Okay, next slide, please. So this is the final slide. So just to give you a recap of everything, we have built a profitable aerospace business. It's roughly 400 crores in this COVID period. It was 500 crores pre-COVID, and it has a very robust and rich profitability. With the commercial aviation sector bounced back on the back of global vaccination and travel and opening up, and advisory just seen from the manufacturers, we are very bullish on this business. We're very bullish on the localization of defense production in India. We believe the time has come. One is intent, which is always there. The second is not just intent, it's a need to do it, because in today's world, there's technology denial, and there's also a need for the Indian government to develop local jobs, taxes, and keep our money here, spend locally. So there's a tremendous opportunity. The same thing is driving the hydraulics division. This Atmanirbharta is driving defense production going forward and agriculture, rural infrastructure trust. And that's giving us pricing power. We've dumped a business that was really suppressing our profitability and really affecting us in terms of management bandwidth. We are reducing debt. We also have 450 acres of freehold land, which has been government is developing two defense corridors, industrial corridors, one in Uttar Pradesh, one in Tamil Nadu. This is the national government, where they've given additional benefits. Our land is at the start of it. In fact, it is the first piece of land that will be the southern defense corridor. It's near the Sulu Air Force Base. So this is a very significant divestment for us. It was attached to give energy to our automotive businesses in Tamil Nadu. We don't need it anymore, so it's a great straight to the balance sheet and will improve our bottom line going forward. We've monetized, of course, the foundry as well, and which reduces capital employed, but it also improves our P&L dramatically. And then, of course, we took 2/3 of our debt and we just dollarized it. It is roughly half of our exports from here, so it's self-hedged. There's zero risk in that but it reduces the cost of finance from 10% to 5% on roughly 200 crores a day. So, which is what we converted to 191. So, with that, thank you for your patient hearing, and I'm very open along with my team to take any questions. I'm sorry, it is a long story. There are a lot of people who don't know our business. I needed to ensure that you understood it, and I hope I've done justice to your time. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We will be opening the Q&A session for participants. Anyone who has a question, please use the raise hand option. Participants request you to limit your questions to 2 per participant. Once a participant is called out, please unmute yourself to ask a question and mention your name and your firm's name. We have the first question from Neville Deria. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Neville Deria from Equirus Securities. Sir, 2 questions from my side. If I understand correctly, you know, we have assets held for sale of rupees 140 crores on our balance sheet. If rupees 56 crores relate to the wind farms assets in Coimbatore, is it correct to assume the rest 84 crores are for the JFTL assets? And any progress on the sale of JFTL foundry business to Danlog Brakes, and the wind farm asset sale?
Thank you, Neville. Thanks. Very, very good question. Both the divestments are in advanced stages. The Danlog sale actually has been executed. But the day we were supposed to get the document from the state land, SIP court, you see the asset is on top of land. To transfer the asset, we need a NOC from SIP court. The day we were supposed to get that document, the whole state went into lockdown. They've just unlocked it yesterday. And they've started going back to work, government offices for 30% work. So we're expecting that document this week. In effect, the asset is already being run by Danlog, because what we've done is we've done a business transfer with all the customers. From the first of last month, all the billing was being done actually by Danlog. So they're actually sitting there. Unfortunately, we're not able to transfer the asset because we don't have that NOC from the government, which we hope to get this week or perhaps next week. So that asset is done. The second asset is, is that a book value? So let me tell you, the foundry has a fixed asset and it has current assets in it. So if you look at the total value of that asset, just to get an idea of how that divestment works out for the company, roughly around 32 crores or 33 crores of working capital will reduce. So eventually we won't need that much. Our working capital needs will come down. But we will actually get in hand another maybe 60, mid-60s, 60-something crores, which will be the net value of our asset transfer after we pay out some things that have to be paid out to, transfer fees to the government and brokerage or whatever. So is that correct, Chalapati? If you just correct me? Just a rough order of magnitude, I'm not giving you the down to the paisa, but roughly that's where we are, right?
Yeah.
So it should reduce the long-term capital one is that money comes in, we are using part of it just to, we don't need to pay down debt because we actually are sitting on cash, as you've seen you'll see in the balance sheet, and we also have, we don't use our limits. But what we're doing is, or all our limits, but what we're doing is we're using part of that money to reduce debt, and part of it is being redeployed into aerospace and hydraulics, where you have a very high return on the capital that will be used. And instead of losing that 20 odd crores on that asset, you'll be earning roughly the same amount. So it's a swing away, which is significant. The rest of the asset is held at book value. Of course, when it's acquired, you get it at a higher, we are going to get a much higher price. I can't say anything more than that. But it will be a very nice reduction in our debt profile. Just imagine 450 acres of freehold land near the Sulur Air Force Base in Coimbatore. So it's a good asset. And of course, we're selling it to the government, so it's a very transparent and clean deal. One of the reasons, there are a lot of the ways you can sell these assets. When you sell land or any of these things, we sold it to a multinational because for us it's very important to have transparency. We're selling it as the second asset to the government, again to be transparent, because this is where there's always a risk. There's always a reputation risk, and there's always the risk of getting entangled into long litigation. We just don't want that. So it takes a little longer to do it, but when it's done, it's really good. Thanks, Nehru.
So my second question is, you know, if I look at your balance sheet, consolidated balance sheet, your long-term and short-term borrowings are at 513 crores, plus 109 crores of other financial liabilities, and 60 crores in cash in hand. So, you know, what would be our net financial liabilities post these two transactions? You can help that to understand.
Right. So, I think post these two transactions, roughly you can say 120 odd crores of the debt will go down, long-term debt. But let me just point out something to you. So, for example, we've been renting a building, or we lease a building in the UK from the Swindon Borough Council. All right. And you see, you know, we've got this AS116. So when you see suddenly there's an extra amount of what is shown as debt, it's actually we've rented this building for 30 years on the back of the future orders we've got from Airbus. We've secured that factory building with the Swindon Borough Council for the next 15 years, but the way it's treated in AS116, that adds back into our debt. I mean, actually, there's no debt in that. It's just a rented building. So, Chalapati will also explain, I think we have roughly 130 or 150 crores, roughly, which is all leased assets, including where I'm sitting right now. In a year, in less than 12 months' time, we'll be out of this facility. And we'll be in our own facility at the Bangalore airport, where we have 29 acres of dynamic land. So this facility that I'm sitting in right now will be handed back. So it'll show a reduction in debt, but actually all we're doing is giving back a building we were renting. So I think you have to look at it when we do the sale of the assets, we will not touch this leased asset. These leased assets will be leased. And there is no long-term liability associated. It's on our books, again, under 116, only to the extent that we are using it. The moment we hand them back, it's gone. But in the form of the real long-term debt that we have from banks, which is roughly, 320 crores of Indian debt and another 7 million euros in Europe.
Yeah.
Right? That's the real long-term debt of the company. We'll reduce that by about 120 crores. Over the next course of the next as we get this money.
Thank you, sir. I'm spacing.
Thank you, Nehru, and thank you for the nice questions.
Thank you, Neville. Next question is from Raja. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. Congrats for the good set of numbers. Sir, I have a couple of questions. The first question is on the segment and P&L implication.
I'm sorry, Raja, I can't hear you, Raja. I'm sorry.
Yeah, is it better now? Can you hear me?
Hello? Are you able to hear him? I'm not able to hear Raja.
In between the implication.
I can hear you, but it's like a whisper.
No, hello, is it clear now?
It's clear. I'll just listen in. It's very
soft. Yeah, Raja, your voice is clear, but it is feeble.
Very feeble, yeah.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes, very clearly. Thank you, Raja.
First of all, congrats for the good set of numbers. Sir, just two questions. On the segmental P&L, I see losses reported under the categories others and unallocated. And if you see for the quarter, they are totaling to almost 12 crores. I just wanted to know any color on that. And, you know, would you expect a similar number go forward as well? And you know, that would be helpful.
Chalapati, may I direct that to you?
Yeah. Thank you, Raja. This is whatever we have disclosed as asset held for sale, like, you know, JFTL related. So that is a loss, whatever has been shown there.
No, but you also have a loss from discontinued operation shown separately, the 1191 under E, you know. I'm talking about the one under shown under others and unallocated of 678 and 475.
Okay. Okay. So like corresponding numbers we had, like, you know, last quarter you had around 560.
Yeah, that's correct.
Hello?
Yeah, that's correct.
Yeah. So this is basically, you know, this is pertaining to other than segment, like we also have corporate, we have you know, other expenses of other than allocable to the segments, so which is shown there.
Yeah, Chalapati, the reason why I'm asking is if you see the year-on-year numbers, the current year you reported 1125 in others and unallocated 1376. That is almost 25 crores of loss. Vis-a-vis last financial year, it was 614 and 902, which is 15 crores. So there's almost a 10 crore movement here. So just wanted to know, is there any one-off sitting here, or what is the kind of a run rate we can take here? Because that is almost like one segment, you know, bottom line, you know, if I add both.
Chalapati, it's the 25 crores. The question is quite clear. This is the 25 crore unallocated number. For the, is this for the quarter, Raja?
No, that's for the year. For the year,
Yeah, right.
Yeah. So, Chalapati, if you don't have an answer, I can even connect with you offline.
Yeah, connect, but it'll be interesting. Yeah. And we'll post that up on the investor presentation, this question.
Yeah.
So even if it's answered to you, it'll be available to everybody. Because we need to understand what number you're talking about, perhaps.
Yeah. Sure, sir. Not a problem.
We'll get back to you on this with the details.
Yeah. So the next question is your aerospace revenue current year, you have done 374 crores vis-a-vis 498 crores for FY 1920. So any color on, you know, what would you expect these numbers to be in the medium term? And also any upside that you will get from the recent Tejas, you know, order that HAL has got from the defense. So any, you know, if you can give more color.
Right. So I presented it to you visually. Let me tell you, the numbers are quite clear. The business is intact. There's no loss of business. There's a reduction in volume because of the pandemic. And unlike the tractors, which are bounced very fast, this is bouncing and you've got a direct guidance from Airbus, which they publicly disclosed. All right. And we are seeing that, and we are seeing it in a very aggressive way, in a very positive way, coming back at us. The question is, we have to see it, and we have to see it develop back to us, that volume to come back to us over the next few quarters. But I do believe that Airbus is going to go back to more than pre-pandemic levels, because the volumes that they've asked us to, that they've publicly disclosed everybody to gear up for, is clearly on the back of reduced competition that they have from Boeing, because the post the 737 MAX, because the duopoly, the A320 family and the 737. So clearly now there's a very big advantage for them on volume. There's a second very big improvement for Airbus. They've developed two products, the A321 long range and the A321 extra long range. These are remarkable aircraft because these are in the same family, but they are extended range, so they can fly like wide-bodied aircraft used to fly, you know, across transcontinental. So in a post-COVID world, one is, if the volumes of passengers are less, you don't have to fill up 400 seats on an aeroplane anymore. You have to fill up 225 seats to fill one of these things up. So you can have what are called the long, narrow flights. It also opens up new routes for airlines. So I think the whole market is going to change quite dramatically in a very positive way for Airbus. Now, coming back to Tejas, again, I've always been a very strong believer in India's defense indigenization, and we've been waiting for it. It moves glacially. I believe the time is here and now. We have developed the first set of major structures for the Tejas. And I do believe they will get a larger number, but I don't have, I mean, it's not that I'm not disclosing something. there's a lot of discussion going on with the customers, but I don't have data that I could really share. But there is certainly a mood of data privatization and production with people like us.
Okay. And so
it's a very nice case now, because what we did was, in COVID, aerospace really hit a rock bottom, and you can see that the business has been fairly robust even despite this very bad time for us. It has to bounce back, of course, because, and by the way, we've used this time to really compress costs in a more permanent way. So we were able to benchmark certain costs, and we were able to eradicate those costs. And I think those will also benefit us across time. Thank you.
Okay. The next question is from Bhagyesh.
Yeah. This is Bhagyesh from HDFC. Hope you can hear me.
Very well. Thank you, Bhagyesh. Thank you, Bhagyesh. Indeed. Thank you.
Just 2%. One is, okay, Airbus industry has given a very strong guidance, and we will do well on the back of that. The only issue here is how much scope is there for us to get the A350 business also. Luckily, we are not in A380, it has been shut. But how much scope is there for us to get into A350 also? So that is doing very well for them.
Right. So Bhagyesh, if you look at the growth that they are going to have, the A350, which was running at about rate 10 a month, is down to about rate 5.
Yeah.
And it's a great aircraft. The challenge that they have is the wide-bodied aircrafts will be partly cannibalized by the narrow bodies, because of what I said. The XLR will start flying certain distances and certain routes that earlier you had the wide bodies doing. And remember, they use a fraction of the fuel. They are much cheaper. And most low-cost airlines have only one model of aircraft. So anybody like IndiGo, who runs on A320 family, which is 319, 320, and 321, if they get a 321 XLR, they can start flying internationally without changing the complexity of the airline or changing their cost structure. That's what's fantastic about this aircraft, why it's so revolutionary, while it's a traditional aircraft. So I think there'll be some internal cannibalization. We do have some campaigns on within Airbus, and they're across all platforms, including 350. So I think two things are there. One is, in the last 5 years, we were really fighting to get credible with all the global players. We built that credibility now. In an aerospace, I mean, look, this is something we started in a garage in 1993. It takes a long time to build a mid-sized 500 crore business, but we are a global sole supplier to these guys. We've got the credibility, we've got all the, you know, the great tick marks of being best of breed. Now we just need to get volume. And for the last 1 year, we've just not been able to meet face-to-face. We've just been on video calls. They've been applauding us for whatever efforts, because we have not, you know, a lot of their suppliers across the world have let them down because of what we've been doing, the anti-COVID stuff that I talked about. We've been ahead of schedule with every delivery. Actually, we built safety stock for them. So I think that's a very good situation once the world opens up and we're able to. Look, I think we're going to start seeing new orders for new products, whether they are civilian aircraft or defense, whether they're global or local, we're going to start seeing them. Up till now, we've been really focused on developing these three big programs because we needed to get them perfect. And now, really, it's the customers who are there for us to hunt for business with.
Okay.
So one is, of course, the growth of the current business, which is what I discussed. I didn't talk about new orders because, you know, I can't talk about them till I get them, but I think for Dynamatic, we're in a very good position to win these orders where we are on campaigns.
Second question is regarding drones. We are a very unique company that will be doing large-sized drones also and the small-sized drones. But as of now, the focus seems to be on defense applications. But over about 5 years, will you cater to the civilian market also? Because that's the talk. That will be very big.
Bhagesh, that's a great question. I tell you, I don't know. You know, part of the corporate cost that we have, the unallocated cost, has been this defense production. You know, we have to actually spend, and it doesn't go into any of our businesses. Partly, it's just research and development work. And it's not all of it. So it's a fraction of it. But it's there. It's a piece. And we've been just waiting. And at some stage, we all have this thought, are we really doing the right thing? And honestly, it is exactly for the question that you put to me just now, that once you get a market for drones that is underpinned by a government order, the kind of spectrum of opportunity, once you get multiple drones flying, the drone licensing and the drone management system, airspace management is available in India, the market will be huge. I mean, India is a virgin market for airspace use, and a lot of industry autonomous, as you very rightly put.
Toby, if I may pitch in, am I audible?
Yes, you are. Very.
So one of the largest markets that we can look forward to once the civil airspace regulation for drones is firmed up is agriculture. If we've been a part of the mechanization, farm mechanization, and we see a great future ahead of us in farm digitization. And with the kind of market share that we have in the tractor industry, I think it's no brainer that this is where we will see a lot of traction going forward.
Thank you, Arvind.
Toby, just to add the points you mentioned and Arvind, and this also will surface Raja's question. Whatever unavailable, as you mentioned, that homeland security, that research and development, what we have partnership with IITs and other things. Second thing is we also set up now our medical division. And last year, before our lab, own lab, we also spent money to test all our employees, 30,000-40,000 tests. So all that, plus wind farm and other things, all stuff is mentioned all together under unlockable. That's why.
You can respond to Raja, and then we'll put that up on the net, that specific question on our investor page, so it's available.
Thank you.
I think you'll find a better answer in writing for the question. Thank you.
Sure. So there's a question on the private tag. How do you mitigate the rising raw material prices in both aerospace business and hydraulics?
Okay, so that's a very simple answer. We have completely indexed the pricing, and we have direct pass-through to all customers. It's immediate. And this is one of the challenges in the automotive industry that we face in India, not in Europe. In everything that we do currently is indexed. So if the price of any raw material goes up, we immediately get a price increase from the customer. So there's a 100% pass through. What is for the first time happening in our hydraulics business is that now we are also getting pricing opportunities on our value add. And that is purely a matter of demand and supply. Demand far outstrips the capability of us and our competitor to produce. It's fully indexed.
Okay.
100% pass through. Yeah.
The next question is from Praveen. Please go ahead, Praveen.
Sir, good evening. Am I audible, sir?
Very, very well. Thank you, Praveen.
Sir, actually, I have been following this company for quite some time. So I have two questions, sir. First one, sir, in the initial corporate presentation, I think I missed dynamic homeland security. I think
yes.
You have not covered on that. So can you please share us the revenue or order book in this segment, sir? And also, sir, like as I can read from your website, you have a partnership with Israel Aerospace company. So any development of products on this side, sir?
Yeah, so Praveen, that's what we've been talking about for the last few minutes. So really, thank you. It's a single slide that I presented, which showed the products. And there are some other products that have been developed by us in partnership with all these guys. and there's a cost associated with that which we've been absorbing every year, and we've been just waiting for, obviously, for the defense market and homeland security. Every year we get some terrorist attacks and something, and there's a response that the government is going to ramp up security, and we've always expected that that market will open up, and it hasn't opened up. So order coming through on those specific products has not been, but what we're expecting now with the most recent part of Atmanirbharta and this positive list, a lot of these things will only be made in India now. There's no way, they have been struck off. If a defense force wants to buy this, they will be built in India. So we have these partnerships with IAI and with HAL, as well as with IIT Kanpur. And up till now, we've been spending money on, you know, we have the former chief pilot of the Indian Army working with us who should fly all the drones up in on the Chinese border and Pakistani border. The whole team of engineers and an investment in developing these things. So we hope to be able to suddenly get a nice harvest from the investments we made over the last 5 years.
Okay, thank you, sir. Sir, my second question, we have around 450 acres of land due to this wind farm in Sulur. So as I can learn, like around 40 odd crore is the book value of this land. So what is the transfer price to the government, sir? What is the actual value at which we are transferring?
Any so the market
ballpark figure will do.
I don't want to put that out publicly, but it's a multiple. Yeah, Praveen, I think you perhaps are based in Coimbatore or Chennai, and you would know what the 450 acres would be worth. So we will get a good price from the government, a fair price.
I'm from Coimbatore, sir. That's why I'm.
So I think it will be a fair price, and the important thing is that there will be a very good development of investment into that area. And this is, as you know, very clean engineering industry with no pollution, and it creates a lot of jobs. So it's a very, it's a sweet spot for industry. Just to give you all an idea of what the defense corridors are, there are two defense corridors, the northern corridor, which is only in Uttar Pradesh, and the southern defense corridor, which is only in Tamil Nadu. Now, I am based in Bangalore, I'm sitting in Bangalore. If we were to put up a project with Boeing over here, and they were to invest, let's say, 20 crores of rupees into something, they'd get an offset of 20 crores. If they were to invest the same 20 crores in Coimbatore, because it's in Tamil Nadu, they'll get an offset benefit of 40 crores. There's a defense multiplier, offset multiplier in both these defense corridors. So there's a massive opportunity for employment and industrialization in the two corridors. And therefore the governments, both these governments are running to, because you know, right now, jobs and skilling is the name of the game. And listen, there's no comparison between Coimbatore and Uttar Pradesh. Defense production will be in southern India.
So can we see a substantial debt reduction with this land sale, sir?
Yeah, you'll see a fairly good chunk of, because whatever we get will be a pass-through. We just want to use that. We don't need the money, so we will use it just to reduce debt, whatever comes. And Praveen, you know, if you're an investor, you should be happy, because whenever you do a sale to the government, it's a straight, transparent deal, right? So it's a very good, it's not some kind of hidden deal with the real estate.
Sir, we trust you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Praveen.
Thank you. Next question is from Rohit. You may go ahead.
Hi, sir. This is Rohit. I really admire the precision craftsman products at DTL, and that is one of the reasons why Theresa May had visited your plant way back in 2016. I have two questions, which have two parts. It might be slightly easier question. So how many of these subsidiaries, overseas subsidiaries that we have, are currently profit-making, if you can share, either at the EBITDA level or at the net profit level?
Okay, so we have three broad subsidiaries. We We have the UK, we have Germany, and we have a holdco in Singapore. And all of them have been profitable for the last 5 years. During this year, the COVID year, we've had a setback on both the volumes because UK is particularly susceptible to, if you saw the video that I showed you, it has all that robotic line. That's a brand new robotic line. We've actually, that building has been, like I said, leased. The equipment is an operating lease in UK or German accounting. It would not account for, it would be off. It would just be charged. And in fact, we don't even pay the, we don't even need to pay the manufacturers because they understand there's a COVID. But under our AS, we are accounting for these. And there's a very, there's been an investment that has moved, that the deliveries have moved 8 months or 10 months to the right. We should have in June last year, and we're just starting deliveries now. So I think if you look at our German business, we will lose nothing this year, during the current year. We lost money last year because of this COVID lockdowns. Mm-hmm. The UK business also, we lost money for the first time last year, only during the COVID. But I can't give you the numbers. If you look back, it's all on our investor page. All the subsidiaries overseas have been profitable. In fact, over the last few years, we were making more money overseas than in India. Right now, we're making most of the money in Bangalore. And we're losing money in Chennai.
So, sir, is there any possibility of streamlining these subsidiaries and trying to fetch more profit from them? Because I understand the cost of employee or labor is quite high in the European Union. So is there any chance that you can streamline so that profitability on a console level becomes slightly bigger for us?
Right. No, that's a continuous process. And as we showed you with the robots, in UK, in aerospace, we had 106 employees or something. And we used this last, we retired about 50 of them, over half of them, because we replaced them with robots.
Okay.
So you have to remember something quite interesting. In UK and Germany, when you put a robot in there, it costs you 1%.
Okay.
Right? And the labor is very expensive. So it's a no-brainer for us.
Mm-hmm.
So what you're doing is you're designing a business where you'll have robots working in UK and you'll have human beings in India assembling those parts together. That's the business model. If you were to do the robotic manufacturing in India, the cost of capital would be very difficult. It would be very difficult to keep the business, the machineries, and have that uptime of 100% that we're able to do in Europe. And the third is there's a huge amount of swap generation, which would just go to a Randiwala, which is what has got economic material value in Europe, which we're relying. So I think it's a combination of the three things. And I put one slide up which had that India, UK with the best.
I
would just go back to that later on and look at that. It's a very interesting value streaming that we've done. And it really works.
So my second question is related to the land banks, which are an absolute asset to DTL. So in total, what is the total acreage of land that DTL holds?
Well, we just sold 15 acres with a factory in Gummipundi in Chennai. We have 450 acres in Coimbatore, which will also be sold. We have 76 acres in North Bangalore, Dumbalapur, and we have 29 acres at the Bangalore airport. And we have a very large facility in Germany, which is also owned by us. The UK facility is rented from the Swindon Borough Council. So that's the thing. We're not a land company. We had a wind farm. And we have a research farm where we do all this tractor hydraulic research, and actually it's now slowly the town is growing in there. So this
future. So since you mentioned the Bangalore property, and it is a prime property, I have been to your plant at Peenya as well, like 3-4 years ago when Hanuman Sharma was the CFO then. This prime property was under the development stage. I believe it was Devna Hardy. So can you take us through the developments that you have done over the last one and a half years or so, maybe pre-pandemic?
Okay, so Devanahalli is very interesting because it's 29 acres. adjacent to the Bangalore airport, and it has direct access onto the airport. So I'm saying from a very strategic perspective, long term, we're making very big aerostructures. This will be quite unique for any private company, you know, that you have direct access onto a runway where you can even go further to the right of aircraft manufacturing, say, 5 years from now. And that is the strategic value. The second element is that our global customers are flying all our products out. If you come to Kenya, which you've been to, you find the roads are very narrow.
Yes.
When you're making small parts like pumps or even the assemblies, the flat drive beam assemblies, it's easy to move it in and out. When you talk about the very large Chinook type of structures or the Bell helicopter aerostructures, you're not. It's very difficult. We're able to only get these trucks in at night. So into Pinya and these narrow lanes and move them out. Mm-hmm. At Devara, you've got brand new infrastructure with very broad roads. We're right at the thing. And by the way, these are all being air freighted to the customer. So it's actually very, very efficient for the customer. Also, you can look at it from a customer base. If we are in a marketing way and we have global customers who we are hosting, they land at Bangalore Airport, which is world class. In 10 minutes, they are in our plant. They don't suffer 3 hours of Bangalore traffic.
True.
You've got to have a mindset where you can sell your product. You've got a world-class manufacturing facility. We have one hangar there already.
Okay.
What we talked about, the little investment we're making, I'll just give you a simple idea. With a 40 crore investment that we are making in Devanahalli, we are moving everything out of Kenya and handing this back to the landlord. So we will save 10 crores of rent every year on a sub 40 crore investment, which is flipped over from our loss-making foundry. So suddenly, what we're doing with that money is we're spending 20 crores to reduce debt.
Mm-hmm.
We're putting 10 crores into hydraulics, and hydraulics, you're seeing a massive growth of 25% this year with profitable growth. So you'll probably get that 10 crores back in, you know, with a 15% EBITDA margin. You get, it's almost a year or 13 months return of capital employed. And then you take 40 crores and build your thing and get out of this old facility of yours, which is rented, and you have a 4-year payback. I mean, it's better than banking it, you know, because our current interest rate is about 6.5%, the blended interest rate.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
So thank you for the commentary on this, and hopefully that we continue to see BDL in black rather than the red on a consolidated level with time to come. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
No, I think you know, two, three things. We were burdened during this growth phase by the fact that we had certain high cost or high loss business. And by divesting of all of this, what is happening? You are taking that capital. The assets are good.
Yes,
but they were not generating wealth. And you're paying a high interest rate in India, you're repaying that debt. So I think two very interesting things happen at the same time, which is not rocket science, but it will flow through to shareholders.
Yes, sir.
To be fair, this foundry, we should have closed it last March. It's taken a year because of this. You sold it to Bangalore, which is part of the match. It's a $2.5 billion foundry group. The CEO has been on 5-6 calls with me over the last 1 year.
Okay.
He's an 65-year-old hands-on entrepreneur. He doesn't do anything normally. He doesn't buy an asset without going and putting his feet on the ground. You know, so finally in September, he kept saying, I'll come. And in September, he said, Toby, this is going on too long. Let's just start negotiating and close this over the video. Which is what we did, and we were supposed to deliver it in April, and then again there was a lockdown. So that's been the delay for us. Otherwise, it should have happened a year ago.
Yes, sir, definitely. Thank you, sir. Right. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rohit. So there are a few questions on the private chat. First of all, what is the CAPEX for FY22 and FY23, excluding the lease assets?
So I mentioned let me answer that one question first.
Yeah, sure.
We have no capex. Firstly, we have no more debt. It's only debt reduction now. The second element is that the capex that we are doing is we are using part of the foundry money to put it into hydraulics and aerospace for the two investments I talked about. Both of them are self-financing in a very good way. But what is interesting is that while the first divestment gives partial debt reduction, the second divestment completely goes to debt reduction. So it's very interesting. Also, the first divestment, for example, when we move out of the PINEA asset, under the 116, this will show no longer as a leased asset. So although you're not using it to repay a bank loan, your debt will visually come down on the balance sheet because this asset which I'm sitting in right now will no longer be classified under 116 as debt, as a leased asset. So it's also got a balance sheet benefit additional to the P&L benefit.
Got it, sir. Sure. And when does the company see itself as net debt zero?
See, you know, if you have low cost of debt, you should have a good ratio. And you should have a certain amount of leverage. See, in India, we've all been used to very high interest rates. I mean, ideally, I'm 56 this year, I'd like to have a zero debt business. You know, the funny thing is, both our bankers and people will start, you know, when you go to zero debt, then the shareholders and bankers will start saying you're too conservative. So I think, I don't want to say, I would personally, having come through a period of 7-8 years of borrowing money to build these assets and struggling with it, I would like to really relax and enjoy being an entrepreneur in his late 50s, right? So, but I will be guided by shareholders there, and we'll be conservative about our numbers in terms of debt. We will never have a high gearing.
Got it, sir. And sir, if we look at the last 10 years' performance, there has been growth in the top line or the bottom line. So, do you think you are about to break out of this status quo and have a new growth trajectory?
So if you look at the last 10 years, the glass has remained the same, but the amount of wood has increased because the aerospace business has now become 33% from like under like 5 or 8%, right? So less than that. So if you look at our business, in 10 years ago, we had almost no aerospace business to speak of. It was maybe 30 crores or so. So the top line has remained the same. What we've been doing is constantly re-churning ourselves to improve the business itself. But where it didn't get visible was you had a burning asset in the form of this foundry in Chennai. And earlier we had an aluminum foundry as well. So you had a series of businesses where we lost that purchasing power. Our cost of maybe manufacturing is too sophisticated and dynamic for these industries. You know, they used to gassito patti suppliers and people are willing to pay that in this hyper competition in automotive. I think what has happened is our standards have gone up to a point where costs have also gone up. And perhaps that's not the business we should be in. Because if I was to show you one slide, we won every award that you can imagine from all the automotive companies. But those awards would be something that all our shareholders would really get upset with, because who wants these awards if they want to lose money? I mean, Duff & Phelps even voted us in, I think, 2018, the number one Ferris company in India. It's got no value to our shareholders, right? And we always believe that with that quality performance, there will be a breakout in that business and that would become a 500-600 crore business with 50-60 crores of value of EBITDA. But it never happened, and we had to just hold the plug. At some stage, we got much better opportunities and bigger fish to fry in aerospace and hydraulics.
Sure, sir. The next question is from Rohan. Rohan, you may go ahead.
Yeah. Thanks. Hi. So my question is on the debt again. So you did mention that debt would possibly go down by around 120 crores. So this is This includes the transaction of the 450 acres of wind farm?
Yes. It includes both.
Okay. And the second question is, so we earlier had this plan of refinancing our debt and converting it to dollar denomination.
That's done. 191 crores has been flipped with the existing banker.
Okay.
And the reason we picked that amount is 25.5 million at that time, at that moment, because we have a export of roughly 50 million. What we said was it would be prudent to have roughly half our annual exports converted into dollars, because at any given time, see, it looks, sounds very good, but what you don't want is if the rupee tanks and goes to 80 or 90, you'll have a huge loss, but we'll also have a huge corresponding gain in our exports. So it's a very nice self-hedge calculation that we did with our bankers who include Exim Bank. So Exim Bank, ICICI, so you really got good banks who thought and sat with them and worked out a risk-free or risk-mitigated. So the cost of finance is much lower for us now. On roughly 100 and on our working capital, we have we're still paying about 10%, but on the long-term debt, 200 crores is at 5%, and 100 crores is which we are going to repay when we do the monetization of the wind farm. That's still at 10%. So the cost of capital really will come down.
Thank you.
So there are a few questions in the chat. So what is the average realization on the slab track B?
I'm a little conscious that this will be I'd love to share it because there's no secret inside, but it may be commercially sensitive for us to give this data, considering that this video is going to be uploaded onto the investor page. There is some sensitivity to our costing and pricing because we are in a very competitive environment, and we're bidding for multiple new programs that we are in campaign. So if you please forgive me, I'd like to pass that question.
Sure, no issue, sir.
Thank you. I'm so sorry. I really wouldn't want to not answer, but it's just commercially sensitive or confidential. I don't think we should really share that. I'm sorry.
Sure.
Thank you.
Arun, you may go ahead with your next question.
Hi, good afternoon, Mr. Malhotra. My name is Arun. I'm a long-term investor in Dynamic Technologies. I'm patiently waiting where the company is heading to. And I'm very happy to see that a lot of optimization in the cost is going on. I would like to see, where do you see Dynamic Technologies in 5 years down the line? Definitely there will be a business plan for next 5 years. I would like to hear from you where you see the top line and the bottom line heading to.
You've not asked me for the next quarter or the next 12 months, which is why I can speak a little more freely. What we'd like to do is grow our business, at least double our aerospace business, right, in the next 5 years. And let me tell you, it should not be something out of the realm of possibility, because we built from a 50 crore business, we built a 500 crore business in 5 years. So really, it would be a subpar performance to achieve that. And if you achieve that, you have a very nice aerospace business, which is very profitable. You know the numbers as an investor. The business would be a very nice business to be capitalized. The hydraulic business also has these amazing growth drivers. And as I said, there's a real opportunity to take our EBITDA margin up from this 15-odd% and start edging to 20%. And suddenly that business becomes magical because it has very low capital employed. All right? It operates in completely leased facilities in Kenya. Our equipment is completely, mostly depreciated. And even to add 70 crores to our top line, they've asked us for just a 10 crore capex. It's a very efficient, neat business. So if you ask me, I think that's what we really like to do, is grow these businesses without the encumbrance of funding a business that is losing money. And actually have debt reduction, not from our operations, but really by selling off all these assets that are no longer of any use to us. But thank you for your patience, Arun.
Thank you. To add a question on top of it, so your focus will be mostly on the aerospace, and the second one will be on the hydraulics. This is what I need to read from you.
Yes. And there's a third driver, which I mentioned during the presentation. I will you on the presentation I made with the slides?
No, I joined a bit late.
Okay, I'm so sorry. So there's a third piece there where we are integrating the German foundry into the strategy. What has happened is, as aircraft production has grown worldwide, there's been a drop-off worldwide in the number of suppliers of castings and forgings in the aerospace industry. So there's a squeeze in aircraft metallurgy worldwide. In automotive, we've had absolutely the opposite. You've had hyper competition when the Chinese got in. Now the Chinese are not getting into defense, Western defense aerospace by any chance. And even companies like Airbus and all are slowly but surely pulling out of China, or not pulling out of China, but not investing more in China. So I think there's a, and also I think with this post-COVID period, there's a strong localization drive like Atmanirbharta here across the world. So in a way, with a footprint in UK, with a footprint in Germany, which is continental Europe, a footprint in a growth economy like India, developing and future economy like India, I think there's a tremendous opportunity for globalization with the local political drivers that are there, right? So I think we'll be able to use all these assets. If you look at us, the asset I'm sitting in has had a foundry here. It was a star. It's currently only aerospace, and it is where all our hydraulics was produced one time. So we are very used to repurposing our buildings and our industrial areas that we own to mutate between places. We just lift the machine lines and we relay them out, and we're able to do it. So I think what we try and do is optimize utilization of these three locations.
Okay. Just add to this question, I have two more. One is, do you think that are we sitting on high value assets which are not making enough money out of it, like the land banks and the high value properties? That's number one. And the question number two is that, do you think the HAL is the only one partner where we are looking for the domestic orders in terms of domestic from the defense sector? Or do we have any partnership we are looking forward in this sector?
So during, thank you again, that's a nice revelatory question that will help all other participants. So like, we developed a very strong relationship with HAL, but it's still, because of public policy, it's still limited. The opportunity now with HAL is massive if the government actually puts its foot on the pedal and produces, in large volume. Let me tell you, nobody's going to build fighter jets. HAL's ready to do it. And then in partnership with companies like ours, they'll be on steroids. And that's been proved. They were very successful in the past with everything they did, and we were part of it. It's just we need more of it, and we hope there will be more. We're actually quite confident with the public policy now, and more than the intent, the need to produce locally, that this will happen. The second question is that during the pandemic, we developed a very interesting relationship with BEL as well. And we delivered some products that were really, if I may say so, very, very difficult. They, what would have taken 2 years to produce in Israel, we did it in 90 days. And they are just, both IEI and GL were very, very happy with the engineering, the quality, and the speed of it. So part of it is because we have this incredible equipment to produce stuff for Boeing and Airbus, and these skill sets and human beings, we're able to pivot and do this stuff. So I think you will see a, if you see the partnerships we have, it's with the DRDO, it's with the Indian Institute of Technology, it's with the CSIR labs, and it's with HAL and BL. So that's a fairly large canvas to have in terms of strong relationships and formal strong relationships. So I served on the IIT board myself 22 years ago. And I currently serve on the CSIR board myself. And so there are a lot of intellectual formal relationships we have, which will probably open up opportunity. But again, it's government, so you know, I can't make a projection.
I invite you to the first question that
sorry.
I asked.
I'm so sorry. The first question, the second was more interesting to me. The first question was covered in the presentation. So you're very right. A lot of companies have to sweat their businesses to pay down capital employed and debt. The fortunate thing about Dynamatic is that we've got a whole bunch of assets that, as you very rightly pointed out, don't generate any return or a very low return, or in the case of the JFL foundry we divested, a negative return. So what we've done is we're those assets, so first we sold our aluminum foundry in 2019. In 2020, we had handshaken with Matt to buy the iron foundry because of the lockdown. It has only just happened. And I would say 90% of the work has been done for the divestment. And really, it's the government is the buyer, right? So it's a great buyer to have, and also it's the right thing. You know, we originally bought this from a Tamil Nadu state enterprise, and it will go back to them. So it's all good karma for the defense corridor. And that will be a significant milestone for us, because it will take out a chunk of debt and reduce our debt and our interest. But you're right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You answered right to the point. I hope and I wish all the best to Dynamic Technologies and the management.
Thank you. 2 out of 3 are done, now the third one. That's all.
Thank you.
Few questions on the chat. So being in the sector, how does the company protect itself from the hackers?
I'm so sorry. Can you repeat the question? From hackers, how we can protect ourselves from hackers?
Yeah.
Okay, we've got something called sandboxing. So we've got a digital sandbox, Israeli sandboxing technology around our network. So our research network is within a sandbox. And we are regularly audited by our customers, and we are an ISO 27000 company, right? So data privacy and data security is absolutely at the top of our list, and it's required because we have to be compliant to our customers. That notwithstanding, there will always be that 1 in a million chance that somebody is going to hack into us. So we're very, very careful about it. Now we're using the latest technology, we're using everything. We just believe that they say.
Sure, sir. And does the promoter plan to increase its holding?
You know, I am at half I don't see a need to change my holding in any way. I consider my holding to be, when I was a youngster, I had only 20% or 22% of the company. I've bought shares all my life. I borrowed money and bought shares. To me, anything above 26% is good. 50% is great. I don't need to own 100% of the company. We've got great shareholders. I just want them to make money, and then if they make money, I make money. I don't make money. I mean, all of us just get wealthier. That's all.
Sure, sir.
Thank you.
The next question, since the contribution of aero business is increasing, would it be fair to assume that your operating margins could go beyond 14-15%?
Yeah, it's what I mentioned, right? As the more that mix, the better it is. And, you know, the challenge is that the challenge always is when you had a negative business, it was bleeding into your positive businesses. So I think you'll have seen the slice diced thing, and it was quite, see, if you're a shareholder, it's quite simple. You sell these shares and you keep the good shares. But in an industry where we were really stuck, our bank, we had a very strange architecture. Our assets that we're divesting now were in the automotive business that was losing money. And the way Indian banks think and work, all your loans are asset-backed. So this is not some very obvious logic that we didn't take a decision. It was just, it was like a puzzle. The assets which were used as security by the banks to lend money for the profitable business, which didn't have much assets, were in the unprofitable business. So we had to literally work very closely, sell one asset, pay the banks, give them, get their acquiescence to sell the, you know, to do all this, because you have to understand, in India, they don't finance cash flows, they finance assets. And then they take your cash flows to service them. So we are stuck with that. And that will get resolved now going forward.
Got it.
I mean, I wish it was just a stop, because I just pressed the button and JFL would have got gone, you know. So we needed permission. It is difficult selling it in India. Industrial businesses with the labor laws, it's just very, very complicated. You want to get in a business, it's quite easy. You want to get out of it, it's almost impossible, unless you own shares.
Yes, sir.
The
next question is from Ronak Cheda. You may go ahead.
Hi, am I audible?
Yes, Yana.
Thanks for a very comprehensive presentation. I just wanted to pick your brains on the hydraulic business. So what I understand is our wallet share goes up tremendously in terms where the tractors have power steering. So if you could talk more there, that what percentage of tractors today come with power steering, and how do you see that trajectory moving forward?
Yeah, so actually that's a great question, and I've got my colleague here, and I, if you don't mind, I'll just request Arvind to answer that, but it's a great question. India is moving hard to pasturing. The tractors are moving from the farm onto main roads, and this is all getting driven by both customer and consumer behavior. The farmers want pasturing now, they're demanding it, and also, there's expected legislation that should happen to get these onto main roads, and that they should have better steering. Arvind, would you care to answer that question? How it will impact us positively?
Thank you, Toby. I would like to address it in two parts, because the question was about power steering and wallet share. So you're right. The tractor industry in India before 2021, before the pandemic hit us, was about 35-40% of the tractors made in India were power steering tractors. India predominantly makes between 40-55 HP tractors, and now we see some growth in 7500 HP tractors. So 35-40% of these tractors were power steering. So we see a pivot. So we mentioned about legislation, but even without the legislation, we see that last year, the year just concluded, FY21, the power steering percentage has gone up to about 65-70%. 60%, I would say. 60% is power steering now. And what we've been told that going forward, this number is only going to improve. So a lot many tractors will be fast sharing going forward. So that will drive growth for us. Just to let you know, and to let everybody else know, that when we talk about a fast sharing tractor and a non-fast sharing tractor, what it means for us is double the number of pumps. So a fast sharing tractor will have double two pumps as against a non-fast sharing tractor. So from there, you can you know, estimate the amount of growth that we are talking about. The second thing you mentioned about wallet share. So we have in India, if I talk about India, our market share in India, our share of business in India with the tractor OEMs is about 75%, between 70 to 75%. And globally, it is about 34%. And that's on the pumps that goes on the tractor. So if we take the Indian market, the value of the pump as a part of the wallet of hydraulics that goes on the tractor is about 10%. So we have 74, 75% share on the tractors on the product, which is 10%. We also make lots of other products which goes onto these tractors, which we are supplying to some of the tractor companies as of now. So these are not entirely new development for us. But we are now discussing in dialogue in very advanced stages of discussions and negotiations with the tractor companies, where we will be supplying most of these products to most of the tractor companies. And so there's a potential to grow this percentage share of wallet from 10% to anywhere between 60-70% and 100%. So that will drive further growth.
Yeah, thanks for that. Just on the legislation, do we expect it in next couple of years, or this is just a thought and probably somewhere in the discussion
of the states? Yes, it's been talked about for the last 2 or 3 years, but increasingly it's become the farmer's choice. There are 3 or 4 very interesting things that have happened in the last year. You know, as you saw last year with the pandemic, we were surprised at the demand that we're getting. Part of it is this transfer to pasturing, where you're getting two pumps per tractor instead of one. But the basic tractor volumes have been on steroids. And one of the reasons, we have people, staff who come from the hinterland, and they told us, that last year when the migrants went back, a lot of these guys who were taxi drivers in urban India, they swore that they're never going to go back to Bombay or Delhi, but they are drivers. They were driving Ubers or they were driving Olas. So what have they done? The cheap financing that has been put in through NABARD, they've become tractor owners, and they're running these tractors in ways that farmers never thought about using them. They go out, they go to small farmers, they plow their fields, then they put a trolley behind and they take a barat to a wedding. Then they take sand from a riverbank to a construction site. So it's become a multi-utility vehicle which is on road and in the field. So if you go on road, you definitely need to have a fast steering, because otherwise it's a very wobbly steering system developed for the field. So I think there's a massive, I don't know, Arvind, what would be your jump in, because we can actually give this data in your tandem pumps, let's say in Q4 compared to, let's say, Q4 a year ago, what will be your growth of tandem pumps? Because that will be the number of fast steering.
Yeah.
What will be the growth?
So Toby and Ronak, between quarter one, FY21 and quarter four, we saw about 70% jump in the pass sharing. Between quarter four FY20 and quarter four FY21, there was about 25-30% increase in the pass sharing tractors. One of the reasons, other than what we mentioned, so to answer your question, a couple of years back, we perhaps needed this legislation to be passed for fast steering, but now since the industry has pivoted towards fast steering, legislation or no legislation, I think this is going to be the way forward. And one of the other reasons, in addition to what Toby mentioned, this tractor is no more just a farming equipment, it's a multi-utility vehicle. So it's being used for construction as well. And that is where fast steering, if one were to ask, why do you see the pivot in fast steering? Why it is happening is because the tractor is now being used as a multi-utility vehicle, and without the power sharing, it would be almost impossible for somebody to drive the tractor. So this pivot is going to be there. We will perhaps see more and more number of tractors produced in India which are power sharing, and that augurs very well for us. It drives growth, and also for a period when perhaps there's a dip, this is a natural hedge. You'll be losing perhaps two tractors, and you know, you will be making it up because the number of tractors with power sharing is going up. So there will be a natural hedge also.
Thank you.
Very interesting perspective. Thank you. Norbert, is it you who asked me the question about shareholding, promoter shareholding? Who was that who asked me about that?
No, that wasn't me.
That was from a private chat.
Yeah.
That was from who? From a private chat. So I had I actually never had that thought before. So I had a little time to think about it a little more, right? And we talked about wealth creation, and so again, we're all shareholders. Some of you are potential shareholders, but I'm talking to shareholders. You know, something quite interesting in Dynamatic, between my shareholding and institutional shareholding, roughly 75% of this company with just 6.5 crores of paid up capital is in maybe 10 hands, right? And it's a real concentration. Globally, when we look at listed companies, there's a very large widespread shareholding. And you know, if one was to really be a little more at a little higher, more enlightened discussion, and not really me in a position as a promoter, how much would you like, I think it's interesting that perhaps, and I'm not saying this about myself, but all the 75% shareholders, including the promoter, if we actually didn't own so much of the company, and instead of 10 or 15,000 shareholders, we had 100,000 shareholders, and you had a more vibrant business in the market. Of course, it predicates on everything that I talked about earlier about us having, getting rid of the stuff that we got rid of, or getting rid of and focusing on that nice space that we built for ourselves going forward. So if we were to, let's say, double the aerospace business and double or treble the hydraulic business, is a really fantastic business. How would we like to be owned then? Would it be, I mean, it's very nice for me to say I own half the business. But if I was to just say, what is the right thing to do? And I'm not saying it again just for myself. I'm saying even for the larger investment community, probably the best architecture of ownership would be to have a stable set of large shareholders, including a promoter with skin in the game and invested and running a business, and to have a nice maybe 100,000 shareholders, not 10,000 shareholders. So this is just again an unthought, or I'm just trying to respond to a question. I think that would create greater long-term collective wealth if any business was owned like that. And I think the Indian IT industry has shown that. All right, with a lot of companies that where the promoters had a vibe. And if you look globally, I mean, look at the hot stocks of Tesla or anything. I mean, you know that Elon Musk owns 51% of this company. You know, you build a good company and then you have wealth creation on a global scale with good shareholders. I think Indian promoters and Indian shareholders, we need to start thinking in a more enlightened way, perhaps. You know, I'd love to own 51%, but is it really something so important? I don't know, actually. And I never had that question asked, so whoever asked it, thank you for asking that question.
Sure, sir. The next
thank
question
you.
Is from Hitesh. Please go ahead.
Hitesh? And I don't own stock in any other company. I own stock only in one company. So, you know.
Right. Hitesh, are you there?
Can you hear me?
Hi, yes.
This is Hitesh from Aksa Capital, and thanks for the opportunity. I had two separate questions, but before that, just a follow-up to what Ronak had asked on the hydraulics business. Last year we had a growth of about 33% in the Indian hydraulics segment, and the industry as such, tractor industry as such, has grown by 24%. And if what Mr. Arvind had just highlighted, that if the share of power steering had increased from 35% to 60%, a growth should have been much higher than 33% in that case, right? So just trying to understand where, what is it that I'm actually missing here.
Arvind, would you like to answer that?
Yeah. So, Hitesh, see, what happened last year is when the industry opened up after the initial lockdown, wave one, remember that the tractor industry did very well in 2020, and last quarter was absolutely flat. So when they opened up, there was a lot of inventory in the pipeline. Inventory that they already had, these tractor companies had with them. Mm-hmm. It was used up in quarter one and for a large portion of quarter two. And hence the growth delta that you mentioned is because of that. Because while the industry grew by that much, our share of business also grew, but they also had the inventory which they utilized in the first quarter and for a fairly large part of second quarter. You will see that translating for us this year.
Sure, got it. Okay, what I wanted to understand is, you know, if you look at the hydraulics business outside India, that business was roughly about 110 crore business in 2014, and that has scaled down to about 65 crores. And not only that, I think the margins there are also pretty much lower than the margins that we enjoy in India. So just trying to understand how different is our UK hydraulics business vis-a-vis the Indian hydraulics business, and the new product development that you mentioned, is that is relevant only to the Indian business?
So Hitesh, UK business is also looking very positive going forward. There are lots of new developments that have happened in UK as well. I'm not sure if I can...
Arvind, I don't mind. I think it's quite okay. Why don't you just put up the one development, the one major development you've done there. It's a phenomenal... because we're going to put this video up on the investor page. So it's okay. We can disclose the new product that we've developed, which is very significant. And it goes to that idea of wallet share,
yeah.
And you see the value. What is it, 2,500 pounds per piece?
Oh, yeah, I will talk about it. I will not present
okay.
It because
if you can just put a picture up, I think it'll be quite interesting for us to show you.
Yeah.
Show that, because then I don't think there's a problem with disclosure, because whatever we speak here is going to be disclosed up on the investor page. So I don't think there's any hidden information that will be not be available to others. It's just whether it's confidential information, which is competitive, we'd not like to do that. So you can share an image of the product.
Yeah.
And if you can share that, I think this will be very useful for all our shareholders. And I see a lot of existing shareholders.
Right.
Who would like to share, because we've been developing this product for 3 years, it's been going through qualification. It's phenomenal. It's just game changing.
I am put that up.
Yeah.
Srini will do that for me. I can explain that.
Yeah.
You know, first, your question that the development that happens in India, is it India specific? The answer is that, the Indian design and development team and the British design and development team, they work concurrently. Most of the development that happens, it is concurrent engineering, and it is geography agnostic. It is, we intend to market this and offer this to our customers worldwide. By the way, most of the products that we make in hydraulics, and Toby talked about briefly in his presentation, they are very IP rich, and they are Most of these are very unique, very bespoke for all these OEMs that we supply to. So they have global, they are developed for global customers, not just for India. This one opportunity that Toby mentioned is a very large opportunity, and without even getting these slides right now, getting the slides on, which Sreeni is trying to do, what we can also do is send it to you, because I have to clean up with some data which is customer sensitive. But I can say that this project alone, in the next 2 years, we are now in the production run. We have completed the proto run, we've completed the limited series production, and now we've started the production run. In next 2 years, will be roughly about the revenue that we made in FY21 from our Swindon operations.
That's just one product. It's a brand new product. It's a game changer.
Just
and it's unique in the world. It's taken us 3-4 years of development.
Yeah. And the second thing, perhaps very important, very significant about, and to answer your question, that one of our largest customers, which is based in America, one of the largest tractor manufacturers, and once again, I would not name them, one of the largest in the world in terms of large tractors that they make. Their volumes this year is going up. They are going up by 50% of what we supplied to them last year. So that will also drive in a good growth for us from Swindon operations. In terms of optics, let me tell you, in India, we work 3 shifts a day, 6 days a week, sometimes 7 days a week, all through the year. Swindon, we operate 4.5 days a week, a single shift. This year, up from September, one project will be taking us to twilight shift. We will be working twilight shift as well. So I've given you just the snapshot in terms of the numbers, which will be one project almost equivalent to our current turnover. And in terms of quantum of work, we will be getting full-scale twilight shift from September onwards.
Yeah. That's quite interesting. Could you just highlight?
Once we have cleaned this retail.
Team that needs to take out the financial data.
Yeah. Some of these are customer sensitive. You know, we are in a competitive market, and I would not want to share it.
Okay. Perfect, Arvind.
Sure. Just if you can just highlight maybe the market opportunity of this new product that we have developed, into which markets would it be catering to?
Okay. So this is, you know, it's not just a product. It's a integrated hydraulic solution. It's a combination of number of pumps and valves that we have built into one. It's very unique, I think, the first of its kind that any hydraulics power does. Currently, it is packaged like this for this one application, one customer that I talked about. Each one of them can be independently sold as a product. And that opens up myriads of opportunities for us, not just in Europe or America, but also in India. And some of these products are would be energy saving. So that is where the future is, that these products, these pumps and these valves that we've built, we've developed, are very energy saving, designed for environment products as well. So huge opportunities going forward for this space.
Sure. Sure. Thanks. And this is the second question on, you know, it's pretty complex, you know, corporate structure that we have, you know, you, both in India, also in Germany and UK, you know, you have stepped down subsidiaries as well. There's a cross holdings across entities. Any plans of cleaning this up and making this quite simple, so that I think, because even if I look at JKM Ferrotech, that is held by both Dynamic Technologies, there's a German entity also which is holding it, there's an Isla Automotive Limited holding it. So, you know, the monetization also, I think the cash flows get diverted to multiple entities, there could be possibly some leakages before we could really realize the true benefits of it. So just trying to understand if any plans of resolving this this complex value.
Yeah, so thanks for this, Hitesh. Actually, you trigger off another thought, which is a great asset. So, and it's a tangential answer, right? But I'll answer your question specifically, and then I'll answer that. It's something that I should have talked about, and it's a great benefit to shareholders. One is the structure of ownership is very simple. All of us are shareholders in Dynamatic, which is the top co. And every entity underneath it is 100% owned by Dynamatic. Most of them are directly owned, with the exception of JKM Ferrotech, which originally was also wholly owned by the German structure. But when we bought the German foundry with an Indian subsidiary. When we financed the growth or the investment in the expansion of the foundry, we directly invested it. So that became a fragmented wholly owned subsidiary rather than a directly wholly owned subsidiary. So that's the only one where there's this kind of mixed ownership, but it's 100% owned by Dynamatic. So at one level, we don't have any minority shareholders at any of the subsidiaries. All right. So that's the exception. Now, coming back to that, partly because of that, we didn't sell JKM Ferrotech. We basically have a very large tax asset in JKM Ferrotech. It's a very large tax asset. Now, one of the reasons why our shares have been suffering, or shareholders have been suffering, is that it was very inefficient for us to have profitable entities fully taxed and have this subsidiary that was burning profit and losing money, which wasn't, we weren't able to offset it against the profitable entity. So if you look at us, we've always been very highly taxed as a consolidated company. We have a very significant tax asset in the Shell JFPL that will remain. And going forward, we will start benefiting. So while we've been in a very high tax kind of environment, not environment, but the structure has created as such, as we divest of the physical asset and we retain the corporate entity, which has the tax asset, the tax loss, we will, over the next 5 years, win that money back. So we will actually enjoy a better tax regime. Because of the carried forward losses that we continue to hold in a subsidiary that doesn't have operations. So I think it's simply owned. The one entity that was not simply owned, it was owned by three of our, by directly by us and by two subsidiaries. That opportunity, we will actually simplify it and we will take advantage of the tax asset that we find.
Sure,
right.
Got it.
But thanks for sharing that thought, because I wish I had stated that in my presentation, that that's also a very significant, I think there's a tax asset of about 100 crores lying in that thing, which, you know, by God's grace, we double the business and do all the good things and have all this high profit, you also have a tax asset to utilize. All right?
Sure,
thanks. All right, was I correct in the...
You're right, Toby.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Given the positive sign, we come to the end of the call. On behalf of MK Global, we thank the management for the opportunity and request the management for the closing remarks.
Now, firstly, I'd just like to thank all the participants for your, very revealing and astute questioning, and it was really a pleasure to chat with you. Normally, I don't chat with shareholders, so it's a long time, and it's been a really nice experience for me as well to be with you guys today. As you can see, we're all at work. Because of our biosecurity, we've not had a single day of lockdown in this particular facility. But we meet all ourselves, we meet each other, we don't meet people outside, so it's been a privilege to also spend this time with you. I'd like to thank MK Global for doing a great job. Ayush, thanks a lot for doing a wonderful job at moderating the session. And what we're going to do is we're going to make this a regular event, and we're going to request you all to track our progress and hold us to anything that we may have said.
Right. So we, if Hitesh is still around, we can put up that slide. It'll just take.
Yeah, why don't you put it up and then you can, anyway, it'll go on to our website in the just thing. I think that's a really interesting product that we've developed. Whoever, whichever participants are still on, it'll be a really good visual to see. Thank you. Ayush, if that's okay with you, just put up one visual that was missed in my slide.
Sure.
It's perhaps the most interesting hydraulic development we've done, but its product has been launched, it has a significant growth to us. So come on, Arvind, put it up.
Right. Just give me a second.
And then you can talk us through what that product is. You described it, but nobody could imagine it.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful hydraulic product. It's many orders of magnitude more complex than anything we do, and it gets us great value. Just to give you an idea, instead of a 2,000 rupee gear pump, that is, 100 times more valuable. But it's more than 100 times more valuable.
Just give me a second. Chalapati is trying to load it. Yeah.
There you go.
And are you able to see?
Yeah, Chalapati. Thank you.
So instead of it going on a tractor, it goes on these very large combine harvesters. Arvind, why don't you talk us through the product?
These are combine headers. As you can see, I've kept the customer name. I have removed the customer name from here, but this is one of the largest manufacturers of combine headers based in Europe. Chalapati, if you can go on to the next slide. This is the product that we're talking about. It's actually not a product, it's an integrated hydraulic system. There are double axial systems, variable delivery axial systems, which are made in the black ones that you can see in between, these are pressure compensated load sensing valves. Very high-end technology here, very high-precision energy-saving products. And what you see at the absolute rear, Chalapati, if you can take your cursor to the end with that black flange and cover there. This is the gear pump. So these pumps are made in Bangalore, and we ship it to, we build them and test them here, and we ship them to Swindon. And they're integrated as a piggyback to these piston pump and valve assemblies. And then there is a filtration unit as well. So it's a fairly complex solution. I would not call it a product. It's a very fairly complex, compact, hydraulic, energy efficient, futuristic product. One of its kind that we have built for this customer. And each one of these can be independently sold as products for different applications. Hitesh, to answer to you, that how do we see future market for these products? So this product in itself is one, the solution in itself is one packaged product, but each one of them can be offered to customers as independent individual products.
Yeah. And this takes us into a completely different realm. Up till now we've been a volume manufacturer of gear pumps. So just point out the gear pump on the extreme right, just a little black flange. Just show that with your cursor.
Chalapati, can you take the cursor?
Yeah, back. That one. Yeah. So that's all which, we're a master of that, making over a million of these every year. But that's a mass production of a product, which is where you got massive market share. Now, this is what you talk about, real wallet share. You talk about something complex, engineering rich, IP rich, valuable, and does the whole job. It's a solution, as Arvind said. It takes us into a completely different realm of being a hydraulic global player, which we are, but in one product.
Right.
Yeah. Thank you, Arvind. Thank you very much. And again, thanks, gentlemen, for your patience.
Thank you so much, sir. We would now end the call.
Thank you.
Thank you.